Yeah. tunambariki Mungu Baba, kwa maana hakuna Mungu kama yeye. In the name of Jesus, thank you. Hallelujah. Just praise the Lord. Tunambariki Mungu Baba, tunambariki Mungu Baba.
Thank you.
Even as we worship Him in this song, believe that there is nothing that our God cannot do. He is here together with us in this service in this morning. Open up your heart and your mind to receive from Him. Hallelujah.
Oh, morning for you, there is nothing that is difficult for him. Doesn't matter what you've been going through, but today, this morning, my brother and sister, I want you to know there is nothing that is difficult to our God. He has been faithful to us. He has owned us, oh God. And my Father, this morning, we thank you. As we say, there is nothing that is difficult to you. Dear Lord, we cast our burdens unto you, for we know you care. We know you mind about us, oh God.
Praise God, Church.
Yes, we are in the house of the Lord, and we do appreciate the goodness and the mercy that the Lord has done upon our life. And today, it's the last Sunday of the month of January. Amen? We've been praying, and God, I'm sure He has heard our prayers. And you who prays in secret, is going to answer you in an open way. Amen? Let's go to our announcement for today. And before I go to the announcement, I would like to know whether we have visitors in our midst. So this morning, you are a visitor and the purpose to join us for the prayers and service. Any visitor in the house? Yes, let's appreciate our sister and our brother here. Thank you so much. We love you and God loves you more. We welcome you in perfect combat. This is where we serve the living God. And after our service, my sister and my brother, we're just going to sit here where our choir is. Our church pastors and our leaders are going to meet you briefly for the official, for welcoming you official in our church. Thank you and God bless you. Announcements. Our first announcement is that we'll have a revival week that is starting from 15th to 20th of February, from 5:30 to 6:45 p.m. Our guest speaker will be Bishop Patrick Kamau from JTB Pepper Church, and all are welcome. You are all invited for this revival week, starting for the week of 15th to 20th. You come and be a blessing, and we'll be blessed all together. Announcement number two is our children dedication will be on 27th of next month after the third service. All parents with children who have not been dedicated are requested to pick dedication forms from the church secretary, fill and return them before 18th of next month. So all the parents would like their children to be dedicated. You follow the instruction of picking the forms from our church secretary, fill and return them before 18. Then the third announcement is our midweek meetings are going to resume officially this week. And on Tuesday is going to be prayers from 5:30 p.m. to 6:45 p.m. And then on Fridays, we are going to have our Bible study. It's going to be from 5:30 p.m. to 6:45 p.m. Then our lunch hour is going to run from Monday to Friday. That is from 12:45 to 1:45 p.m. I invite you all to our midweek meetings. Come and be blessed. Our fourth announcement is the youth of our church. The Department of the Youth is having a Valentine dinner. That is on 14th February here in church, starting from 6 p.m. The charges for the Valentine dinner for the singles is going to be 1,000, and the couples are going to pay 1,800. So the youth and the youth department is inviting you for this Valentine dinner. Then the fifth announcement is our amnesty. They have carried us, and they are going for 150 shillings. The man is coming to an end. If you don't have a carrier, you can pick you up here at 150 shillings, and God is going to bless you. Then announcement number six is that Isiri section 3 and 7, home sale, they are meeting shortly after the Swahili service today. So if you come from Isiri section 3 or 7, there's a meeting for your home sale. You belong to this home sale after the Swahili service, that's purpose to attend. The announcement number 7 is that the intercessory ministry will have their seminar on the 12th of February, and the guest speaker will be Pastor Elizabeth Wawelu, and all are invited. Then the announcement number 8 is that the women department will have prayers and fasting on 5th of February from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. And on top of those announcements, we're also to bring this announcement to the church. Those who have not been vaccinated are requested to meet at grade 4 class for the first and second and also the booster. Yes, you might be here, maybe you got AstraZeneca, Moderna, or Johnson. Still, after Omicron came, we heard that there is a booster. So those people who like to get a booster job, just go to grade 4 and you're going to get your booster for the first and the second dose as per the government directives.
Then the other announcement is this the year of the election in our country, and therefore the government is emphasizing on the registration. So if you're not registered as a voter at our parking lot, the IEBC people are there. So those who have never registered, you are requested to go there and register, more so for the youth, because those people who are aspiring for different seats, they are targeting vijana. Hivyo vijana, tujikakamue, tujiandikishe kupiga kura. God bless you, those are the announcements. May God bless you, and thank you for giving me time and listening to my announcements. God bless you. So this time I'm just going to invite our bishop to take us through. Just as he comes, so to appreciate the salve of the man of God, it's not to be a commitment.
Thank you, Danemis, for leading us quite well. God bless you, Asante. We want to receive our tithes, then offerings, in honor and worship of God this morning. So I can request if you came with your tithe this morning, you can raise your hand, or missions offering, or special offering, that is the envelope. Just raise your hand, our deacons will give you an envelope. Keep it up till you get it. And then at the same time, I invite the choir to come, the minister to us in a number. And then we'll receive the tithes first. The tithes or anything that is in the envelope first, and then we receive our offerings at the nearest offering bag. So I kindly request Elder Nancy, if you can pray for the tithes and offerings, then the prayer will be up on stage. We'll give as a minister to us this morning. So if you can get a mic for our elder to lead us in a prayer for the giving. Tony, if you can get a mic.
Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, this morning we come before you. One thank you, King of Kings, because you have been good to us, Jehovah God, all the way to throne. You have helped us to work in our various places, and you have raised us in circumstances. Jehovah God, we are here to bring part of what you have asked us to do. It's just a little amount. But we are praying that, Jehovah God, you may expand our boundaries in whatever we are doing. That, Jehovah God, we may be able to bring more into our houses so that there will be no lack. Bless each one of us. And also give us good health coming week, that you will be able to concentrate on our work, Jehovah God. We thank you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Those watching us online, you have our details from the MPS and the PayPal number, so you can send your offering and your tithe, and the Lord is going to bless you. Also for us who have money in our MPS, we want to send our tithes and offerings, the details are on the screen, and on the walls, the Lord is going to bless you as you give. So let's have the tithers come and give their offerings. And give their tithes first in the baskets, and then later on we'll have the offering. So if you have your tithe, we start with you, we receive all the tithes, then we have an exchange of the baskets, and receive offerings, and God is going to bless you. Can we require? Hebu simame tu kwa dakika moja, and just raise your hand up. We give you praise, Lord. Santa Jesus, we give you praise, we give you praise. Come on, just worship the Lord for a minute. We give you praise, Jesus. We thank you. We give glory to your name. We bless you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we love you. We thank you. We thank you. Great is your mouth. Great is your master, O God. Rando Roshekiri Tapura Bazia. Manta Karabasha Tapura Bazini Retokoro Bazia. Jesus, 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 Jesus. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. As we raise our hands to the Lord, and ask Reverend Jerome just to commit us to the Lord in prayer, and the Lord may minister to us and even touch us right at the point of our needs this morning.
Father, we want to reverence you. I want to bless your name, Lord. Lord, as we now stand, help each one of us, Lord. We may pray and not fall into temptations, Lord. Lord, even as you come back, may we prepare, Lord, even to be partakers, King of glory, of the feast that shall be in heaven, Lord, my Father. Lord, I want to pray that for every need that is presented in this place, my prayer, Lord, is that God, you are going to meet each one of us, Lord, at our very point of need, Lord. We thank you, Lord, because when we pray, you hear us, Lord, and even you answer us, Lord. We thank you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray.
God bless you. In our seats, I want to bring in our speaker. So, Katia, please, you can go. As Katia comes, I want to do also, she comes, before she speaks, I want to do an announcement. It's a wedding band. They are moving away to Leo. Pastor Elizabeth and Michelle. And Isaac and Yango Lodge. So, Zipo and Yango Lodge are in the evening. So Pastor Elizabeth is not to us, she's one of us here, we thank God. So the wedding will be on the 19th of February, this coming month of love, at Pefa Donholm from 11 a.m. And thereafter reception at KAG East University, that is in Buruburu, from 2 p.m. So we are all invited. And at the same time, the pastor's office is open in case you have an issue that you want us to address. But as a church, let's pray for them. So Isaac comes to us from Donholm, but previously he was here, and he went to a Donholm Pfeffer church, and that is why the wedding will be there. And so the invitation is for all of us to put that day in our diary, just to go and celebrate with our pastor. And again, today in the afternoon, right here in the church, they'll be having their pre-wedding. So kindly be of a blessing to them. You can chip in and help them, even as they demand for their wedding day. So let's celebrate them. Asante, let's appreciate you. Asante, and can you take the microphone to preach? Karibu.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Our viewers from all over the world, whether it's an afternoon or a morning or an evening, we greet you. I'm excited to be here today and to share the word with us. I want to talk about missions, evangelism, because I love missions, and particularly I love missions to teenagers and to children. I love missions to schools. That's what I've been doing for the last couple of years, since 2007. I started doing high school missions, and it's been quite a journey that I've come to love. And every time I go to a school, young people getting saved, it really encourages me because I got saved when I was a young girl, growing up here in church. For those who know me, know I grew up here. My mom used to work here, and so we used to live in a certain house at the corner there. For almost 20 years, 20 plus years, we were here growing up here. And I loved everything, Sunday school, I loved everything about church. And just growing up here, seeing everything happen here, it's just an amazing thing. And this is an encouragement young people, that there is hope for us as young people, and we can serve God, we can be consistent, we can serve God in what He's called us to do. It's possible, it's doable. So since 2007, I've been doing high school ministry, first school I went to, I was in primary school, and so I went with the other team back then, Komodai Girls. And as a missioner, you can imagine altar call in the Itwa, and of who gets saved, of course, and the chap will call for mission. And I remember Pastor, back then, Rev. George calling me and saying, Choma, nakujaje kama mission, and then unaokoka kwa permission field. And so for me, it's just been a journey. In 2007, just after I was done in high school, the first invitation I got was for Kid Girls. And so I went to Kid Girls, met over 400 girls seated in one hall. Nikapata homa, all of a sudden, nikaanza kukohoa, nikaanza kuwa na running nose. Like, I freaked out. I thought I was going to meet just like maybe girls or less than that. But I go there, I meet over 400 girls, and I go home and speak about a bilomo and a kajua, kakanishika, you know, and I was in Toredo and Titi. They called me aside, wakanietelea mkono, wakaniombea uoga ikatoka, I preached. And since then, the school has been giving me an opportunity every single time to go there and just minister. Last Sunday, but one, I went there with Bonnie and Mrs. Bemba, Bishop Bemba, and I preached, and one girl gave her life to Jesus. Then on Sunday, we went to Olkejuado Boys. Olkejuado has a population of about 1,500 young men. And so seeing them seated in our hall, listening to the word of God, and responding to the word, for me, again, looking at those young men give their lives to Jesus, it's really an encouragement. So again, at Olkejuado on Sunday, two young men gave their lives to Jesus. And so today I'm standing here to speak to us about missions, because I love missions. I've been to schools. I served with a ministry called Commissioners for Christ, and I love doing high school ministry. Some years back in 2008, just when we were having the post-election violence, Rev. Collins and I went to Starehe, the region, the schools around Starehe region, and we knocked on every school and requested the mistress or the masters to give us opportunities to speak during the PPI. And so we served with Pastor Collins and some other guys in Ajenifaki, in Ajenifaki Champion, in Ajoel. We'd go in the morning on Wednesdays and on Fridays just to minister during the PPI. And so what I'm saying is that the harvest is ripe. The harvest is plentiful. But the problem is with us laborers. Many of us are not available for missions. And so as I speak to us today, this is just a call to all of us to love missions, to love, speaking and telling people about Jesus Christ, because these are end times. Matthew chapter 24 speaks about the end times, speaks about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as I'm speaking to us this day, all signs are pointing to the reality that the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is at hand. You might be 70 years, you grew up hearing, soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King. And I'm sure you that soon and very soon. That has become my every Sunday song, that soon and very soon we are going to see the King. And the Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, and also 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, that Jesus or God is willing that all men may be saved. God wants all people to be saved. His coming is at hand. He promised that he will come back. And some people feel like God is slow in fulfilling his promise. But the Bible says that he is not slow as some of us might think, but he's patiently waiting for men, as many as possible, to come to the saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is waiting for many to repent so that nobody perishes. God does not wait for anyone to perish, but he wills that all of us, anyone, everyone, whoever may believe in his son Jesus for eternal life. So the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is at hand. And we don't want to lose anyone. We want to have as many as possible in heaven. And so the challenge is on us. Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus said, the harvest is plentiful. The field is ripe for harvest. but the problem is with the workers. And he challenged us to pray that the Lord of the harvest may send workers in his harvest field so that we can harvest souls for his people. And so today that's what I want to speak about, because I love missions. And I love to see souls. I love to see especially children. I love to see teenagers giving their lives to Jesus. I gave my life to Jesus when I was, I think, 13 years. Apart from Jesus, I remember at 13, 14 years, I was serious in the conquer. So it's kind of what time you think the fifth floor, when you will conquer, is the one. Sita toi ke ushubaya, sita ona cha kudirudisha nyuma, maana za kudirudisha nyuma so mengi. But the grace of God has really been sufficient. So it's possible for young people to give their lives to Jesus, to serve the Lord, and to live for Him, and bring glory to His name. So throughout the Bible, we see that God is a missionary God. He's working to create a community of redeemed people from all tribes, from all ethnicities, from all nations, from all over, so that they may glorify His name. So Jesus said, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So pray to the God of the harvest to send laborers in His vineyard. In Matthew chapter 28, just after resurrection, Jesus gave the great commission to His disciples. When the 11 went to meet Jesus in Galilee, the mountain where Jesus had told them to go, in verse 18, the Bible says that Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always to the very end. So that is the master's commission. That is the greatest commission. That is the greatest commandment that Jesus left with us. That He's given us authority. And on that premise, He's sending us to all nations to make disciples from every tribe, to make disciples from every ethnicity, to make disciples from every nation, so that His name may be glorified. In John chapter 4, verse 35, and this is just after Jesus has had an encounter with the Samaritan woman. And the disciples come and meet Him talking to this woman. And they are wondering, what are they talking about? And Jesus looks at them and He tells them, I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. That's the saying, one sows and another one reaps. It's true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done hard work and you have reaped the benefits of their labor. So Christ is telling us the harvest is ripe. Someone has gone ahead of us. There are people who've done frontier missions. There are people who've gone to unreached people groups and they have preached the gospel there. So it's made the way possible for us to be able to go and just do a follow up so that many lives may be saved. The harvest is plentiful. The fields are ripe. It's up to me and you to go out, partner with God, and, you know, evangelize and draw me to Himself. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 through to 38, Jesus went through all the towns, in all the villages, teaching and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, healing every disease and every sickness. And verse 36 says that when He saw the crowds, He had compassion on them. When we see the crowds that are perishing, when we see people who have not given their lives to Jesus, we need to be moved with compassion. Everywhere we go, we need to be moved with compassion so that we can be able to preach to them. And verse 37 says, then He said to His disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into His harvest field. So we see that Jesus, everywhere He went, in the towns, in the cities, in their synagogues, He preached and proclaimed the kingdom. He saw people who were lost and He had compassion on them. May we be moved with compassion when we see many people out there who do not have a relationship with God, and be moved to go and speak to them, be moved to go and invite them, be moved to go and witness to them so that no one perishes. But all of us can have eternal life. God gives His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And the Bible says in John chapter 3, verse 16, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but we have eternal life. But it takes you and I to be willing to go and invite them. It takes someone to be willing, someone to be obedient to the
command them to go and preach to them so that they may come to repentance. Also looking at Luke chapter 10 verse 1 and 2, the Bible says, after this the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. So when we're looking at the nature of this great commission, it's such that we go to all nations, is that we may preach the good news to everyone who cares to hear. And as many as you hear, they will respond to the gospel. So the nature of this gospel is a command, and it's not for the evangelist. It's not for the pastor, but it's for everyone who is called by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. All of us as Christians, all of us as believers, even those who are watching us online, every one of us has been called to be a soul winner. Every one of us, right where we are, in our offices, in the marketplace, right in our own homes, in our neighborhoods, within our families, God is calling us to be soul winners. Let me ask every one of us, when is the last time you witnessed to someone? I'm not asking you to raise your hands. But when is the last time you shared the good news with someone? When is the last time you invited someone to believe in Jesus Christ? When is the last time you brought a soul into the kingdom of God? Someone has done the hard work. They've done frontier missions. Nairobi is almost fully evangelized, apart from maybe the Somalis, the Nubis in Kibra, and also the Hindus in Parklands. But majority have had the gospel. Someone has done the hard work. So for us, we're just going to harvest. When we look at the scope of the Great Commission, as we read from Matthew chapter 28, no single ethnic group should be left out. Everyone, every single individual must hear the gospel. And Matthew chapter 24, verse 3-14, the Bible says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations as a witness, and then the end shall come. Jesus is coming, but then he's not going to come until every year has heard Christ being preached. The harvest is plentiful. So many people out there are lost. They're just waiting for someone to go and preach to them. That is the scope. It covers everyone. Nobody is beyond the reach of God's grace. Everyone can be reached. Even the people groups that have not yet been reached, the Hindus here in Parklands, the Somalis right here in Sili, we can reach them because that is the heart of God. The heart of God is the world, so that everyone may believe in the Son Jesus Christ and have eternal life. Looking at the urgency of the Great Commission, this has nothing to do with the pace, but the priority. Every one of us, if there is anything that needs to be a priority for all of us, because the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is that time. When you look at Matthew chapter 24, it talks about the end times signs. We see the wickedness, we see the wars, we see what is happening in the world, and that shows us that for sure the harvest is plentiful. The field is ripe for the harvest. The big challenge is, are we available? Are we willing to go and invite and tell someone about the love of our Lord Jesus Christ? So, the Great Commission is such that this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. This ought to be a matter of priority. Many of us are looking for ways we can do great things for God. We are looking for things we can do in the church. But I want to challenge every one of us. Let's take evangelism seriously. Let's take missions seriously. Let's partner with God. Let's be the feet of Jesus. Let's be his mouthpiece. I love what he told Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, that before you were conceived in your mother's womb, God already knew you, and he appointed you to be his spokesperson. God wants you to be his spokesperson to every ethnic group, to every person, so that everyone hears the gospel and responds. And then this gospel of the kingdom will be preached to all nations as a witness, and then the end shall come. And God is not willing for anyone to perish. He wants people to repent. But then how can they repent unless you and I go and tell them that they need to repent? I'm speaking about missions. And this is an encouragement to every one of us. By the time we are coming to the close of this service, ask the Lord, God, how can I partner with you? What can I do in the missions field? Why the urgency or priorities? Number one, the harvest is plentiful. Number two, these are the last days. Number three, God wants people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. And number four, there is power to salvation in the gospel itself. Romans chapter 1 verse 16, that's what the Bible says, that the gospel has the power to save lives. So why we need to take missions as a priority, as a matter of urgency, it's because the harvest is plentiful, the fields are ripe for the harvest. And God is not willing for anyone to perish. He wants everyone to come to repentance. He wants everyone to get saved. He wants everyone to come to the saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And there is power in the gospel to save. So it's up to me to take this gospel, go out there, tell someone about Jesus, tell someone that Jesus loves them, and call them to come. While I still reside, praise the Lord. How I pray that this becomes a prayer for all of us. How can we partner in the mission of God? When we look at Genesis through to Revelation, we see the mission of God. We see God is in business of redeeming a community that will worship Him, a community that will, you know, celebrate Him, a community that will be of a redeemed kind of group. So He's a missionary God, and He's calling us to do this together with Him. And so the question is, what are you looking for? What is that great thing you want to do for God? And I challenge you, the one thing that God wants all of us to do, two things that are important for me. Number one is for us to go out there and evangelize. The second thing which is of importance is for us to be able, you know, imagine all tongues, people from all ethnic groups raising up our voices in worship of our God. It's just going to be amazing. So two things that matter is to go out there and evangelize so that worship will be from every ethnic group, from every nation, from every tribe, from every tongue. All of us raising our voices in worship to God. This is a challenge to every one of us. You may never have participated in a mission. And you don't have to go to Garissa for you to be called a missionary. You can be a missionary right where you're seated, right where you live, right in your neighborhood, in your workstation, whatever it is, you can be an evangelist right where you are. You can be a missionary right where you are. This is a challenge to all of us. Vile una feel vizuri mwokoka, wacha kama kuna hile pia feel vizuri akiwa mwokoka. But they will not feel good kama wewe na mimi hatutawaelewa. So what can we do? Number one, we can pray to the Lord of the harvest. As Matthew chapter 9 verse 38 and also Luke chapter 10 verse 2 has told us, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send workers into His harvest field. Why? Because the harvest is plentiful. Why? Because the field is ripe for harvest. So let us, all of us, pray. Let us ask the Lord to send the laborers, to send workers in His vineyard, because the harvest is plentiful. But the workers are not there. And as you're praying for God to raise a band of workers, pray that He may also send you. Pray that He may give you the courage, the boldness to go and invite people into this kingdom. Pray for workers. And as you're praying for workers, usiombe Mungu atume, omba Mungu nitume. Say, Lord, here I am, send me, I will go. Let this be our prayer. All of us, right where we are, let us ask the Lord to send us as harvesters in His vineyard, because the harvest is plentiful. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6. Paul anasema, woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. Woe to me as catcher if I don't tell a teenager that Jesus loves them. Woe to me if I don't tell a fellow youth that Jesus loves them. Woe be to me if I don't tell someone about the love of Jesus Christ. That He died for them. That the greatest demonstration of love is that God gave His only begotten Son to die for them. Woe to me if I don't tell someone. And Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 18. Again, Ezekiel and Asena, when I say to the wicked person, you will surely die, and you do not want them or speak out to dissuade them from their evil ways in order to save their lives, that wicked person will die for their sins, and I will hold you accountable for their blood. Look at that. When I don't tell a wicked person to quit their sinful lives and turn their lives to Jesus, God holds us accountable. God holds you accountable. When you work with someone in the same office and you don't tell them about Jesus Christ, when you're in the marketplace and you don't tell someone about Jesus, God holds you accountable. How I pray that all of us ask the Lord to send us as workers in His vineyard. The second thing that you and I can do, in Luke chapter 14, verse 15 to 24, Jesus talks to His disciples about this guy who had organized for a party, a great banquet, and He sent invitation to people. And then when the day came, verse 16, the Bible says, Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, He sent His servants to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' Unfortunately," verse 18, the Bible says, "they all alike began to make excuses." There is a great banquet that God looks for us to go out and invite many people. Because it's not yet, He wants us to go and invite as many as possible. But what are we doing? We are always making excuses. I am not available. You know, like in Jesus' time when He was telling this story, He says that some came with excuses. "I just got married, so say it don't get the honeymoon. Mungine, oh, I just bought an oxen something, and so say it don't end up. Kujaribu. Mungine, oh, nimenunua gari mpya, hata leo ndio naenda road trip we test." You know, all of us make excuses. But the Bible says that we ought to, you know, be very intentional. We need to be very intentional. Don't make an excuse. Don't excuse yourself, "Oh, sina maneno, oh, he has an evangelist, oh, he has a pastor." No, let's stop making excuses. Let's go out and invite many guests as much as we can. Because the heart of God is for the whole world. It's not a matter of whether God wants people to be saved, but do we want people to be saved. God wants everyone to be saved, but do I want everyone to be saved? Do I want my neighbor to be saved? Do I want my friend to be saved? It's simple. Like this great banquet, we are to go and invite. All of us, it's our responsibility. The nature of the Great Commission is that every believer, every person who says that I am born again, ought to go and invite. The third thing that you and I can do, in Luke chapter 15, the Bible talks about three lost things. The first one talks about the lost sheep. The second one talks about the lost coin. And the third one talks about the lost son. So like the lost sheep, we are to go and find it. That which is lost, those who are backslid, we are to go and find them and bring them back to the fold. In verse 4, that is Luke chapter 15, verse 4. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulder and goes home. So every one of us, there is someone who is lost, is a lost sheep. Probably they were in the fold, they were born again, but somewhere they left the fold. We are to go after them. We are to go and find them. Those who are lost in the world, we are to go. As long as you are a Christian, as long as you are a believer, thank God someone preached to you and God saved. So even now, we have a responsibility to go and find someone who is lost and bring them to the fold. And the Bible says that when he finds it, he calls his neighbor. That's a party, celebrates, because there is great rejoicing in heaven when one soul, not 10, not 100, but just one soul, when it comes to the saving of the Lord Jesus Christ. Number three, like the lost sheep. We are number three and number four. Number four, like the lost coin, we are to search for it. In Luke chapter 15, verse 8 to 10, the Bible says, "Oh, suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light up a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds?" So all of us, as Christians, as believers, we are supposed to go searching. They are out there lost. It's up to you and I to go out there searching for them. But you see, the problem is, in that sense, that we are satisfied sitting here in church waiting for them to come. But who is going to invite them? You and I have a responsibility to go searching for those who are lost. Go searching for them in prisons. go searching for them in high schools, go searching for them in primary schools. I love how Dietal Moody says, a story is told of him, that he evangelized and only three people got saved. And when he was asked how the crusade was, he said, two and a half people got saved. And so the person was wondering, so you mean two children and one adult got saved? And he said, no, what I mean is that two children and one adult got saved. And he went ahead to explain that when you save a young person, you save a whole generation. Majority of us considered in this sanctuary have lived half of our lives. But when we go out there to a primary school, in that PPI class, in that Sunday school class, and you tell a child about Jesus Christ, and they put their hope in Jesus Christ, a whole generation is saved. Praise the Lord. So every one of us, do not even ignore children in your neighborhood. Tell them about the love of Jesus Christ. Don't ignore that teenager just because they are snobbish. No, go after them, search for them, tell them about the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when you save one, you save a whole generation. The last one, the second last one. Like the prodigal son, we are to pray for sinners. And when they repent, you know, as Christians, sometimes you are very selfish. Umeenda tu vizuri umhubiria mtu na amekoka. Akija kanisani tunaanza kuwajudge. Oh, sijui amevaaje. Oh, sijui ni mchafu. Oh, sijui. Let's bring them to church and let's allow God to work on them. Let's allow God to transform their lives. Huyu teenager ako na hizo madread. Wewe wacha kumwambia God. Let them come. Let them come and allow God to work on their lives. Parents who are here and your children have rebelled, let them come. Let them come. I loved it one day, Pastor Yomu stood here and said, anafurahia sana kaza zile anaona watoto wanakimbia kimbia huko hata waingie kwa class. The fact that they came kwa hii compound in itself is enough. And God is able to minister to them. So do not ignore even the little ones. Share the good news with them. The harvest is plentiful. The workers are few. Let's then pray to the God of the harvest to send workers. And may we pray that God, as you send them, send me as well. How many of us are making such a prayer? And say, God, God, if you're looking for missionaries, please, here I am, send me. I'm going to be available. I don't know what I'm talking about, but it's okay. But let this be our prayer, that God will transform lives. Let's pray for sinners, that they come to the saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when they come, let us embrace them. Let us mentor them. Let us disciple them, because God is calling us to make disciples of all nations, disciples of all ethnic groups, disciples of all social statuses. That's what God is interested in. And finally, you might be here, you're saying, please, I am not available to go for missions, I'm not able to go to that high school you're talking about, I'm not able to go to that prison you're talking about, but you can be, you can send someone to go in your behalf, you can give your resources. You can give your money to support, you know, mission works. There is a lot of, you know, missions happening in this country. Are you partnering with God with your resources? Give him so that someone will be the feet of Jesus to people who have not yet been reached. You can give financially to support missions. I love it, Pepper Gikomba is going for missions. It's not for missions, crusades. And I'm looking forward to do. And I thought COVID came and spoiled nearly everything. But it's time. The harvest is plentiful. We need to go out there. We need to go out there. Preach Jesus, because his coming is at hand. What has he given? And God does not will for anyone to perish, but he's willing that all of us partners with him goes out there, preaches, and, you know, draw men to himself. So we can partner with God by giving, so that someone else can be able to go. And there are so many ways you can do this. If you really disturb our missions pastor, keep coming to him, pastor. Is there a mission that I can support? I am sure there will be as many as possible. So if you want to partner with God in giving your resources to support missions, to support, you know, volunteer missions, even to enrich people's lives, come disturb them, you know. Give him work, a lot of it. What has he given? And I know we'll be able to go out there and invite me. So as I come to a conclusion, my challenge to all of us is this. Let's be intentional. Intentional in prayer. Prayer for workers. Praying for sinners to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray for workers. Let's pray for sinners to repent. And when they come, let's accommodate them. Let's embrace them. Let's mentor them. Let's disciple them. Let's help them to become Christ-like. Let's be intentional about going. Right where you are, go. Become the mouthpiece of God. Share the good news with someone. Tell someone. Be intentional about telling. Be intentional about inviting. And when we do that, the name of God will be glorified. As all of us gather many tribes, many times, lifting our worship to God. Let us just bow our heads down. And for a moment, I don't know what you're doing with your life. I don't know how many people you've been able to share the good news with. I don't know how many people you've gone to. I don't know how many people you've invited. I don't know how many people you have told. But ask the Lord to help you. The harvest is plentiful. The workers are few. Let's then pray to the God of the harvest to send as many as possible to his work.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We receive your word with gladness and at the same time with a challenge. The Lord will rise up because the harvest is indeed plenteous. And you've positioned us in various places. The Lord will be your mouthpiece. May you help us in the marketplace, in our workstation, in our neighborhood, in our realm of influence, that Heavenly Father will speak about your saving grace. And we pray then for us as a church. May you cause us to rise up, dear Lord, and be of impact to our neighborhood, to our nation, to the world at large. Because, Lord, you will give us a heart for mission, a heart after you, dear Lord. We pray and trust that, Lord, will give us resources that we need, Lord, to do your work and to do missions in our land and even beyond. And, Lord, for the word that we received today, Lord, it is so practical. It is calling us to action. May you help each one of us to rise and do something. And Lord, cause your kingdom to expand, to enlarge, and to be of impact, O Father. We bless the minister, grace upon her, and favor upon her. And Lord, we thank you that even as we leave this place, that fire that is in our hearts will burn one more time. As we do missions and reach out to those who are lost, O Father. We give glory and honor to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shall we stand? Thank you for that powerful word. And my prayers that the Lord will help us to be his mouthpiece, mahali ambapo ametuweka. Be the mouthpiece of God where God has put you. Support the work of missions. And I believe the Lord is going to be gracious to you. For us to take note of our envelope, there's always a slot for giving towards mission. And we appreciate that we do a lot of school. Right now we are doing a lot of school missions. Prisons are still closed, but we go to prisons. And we do many other forms of mission, going to churches, doing crusades, and many other things. And all this is dependent upon us sending. So the Lord bless you as you consider once in a while or supporting the work of missions as we do it as a church. Raise up your hand as we share the word of the grace together. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us, and we appreciate it. If you came late, we'll have an offering back here. Maybe you came with your tithe or offering, there will be an offering back with a beacon here just to help you out. God bless you as you leave Asante. If we can have a beacon with an offering back, haparakaraka.